Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Escape Pod. Thank you so much for escaping with us. That's Andrew. I'm Alex.
And as always, with great power comes great co-host Garrett ability. Woo!
Yes, sir. That's world famous, co-host Garrett.
Well, that's what the patrons voted for, by the way.
Yeah.
Whoa. No way. Yeah. I am honored. Thank you. Thank you.
And, well deserved. Obviously, we have a reoccurring guest. This is your second appearance on the pod. This is Blake's Takes with co-host Garrett. Yes, we are so excited to have y'all here in Los Angeles.
Yes, baby. Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
We are so excited to be here.
In the studio.
Mm-hmm. Amazing studio, by the way.
Thank you. Thank you.
They're the second guest to appear the second time.
Ooh.
Not including Connor, because he's on Patreon episodes. Soups has been on two episodes. That's it.
Soups and Blake's Taste.
I think you're incorrect.
Fight me.
I just can't tell you why you're incorrect. Are we counting cameos?
It's kind of how you do your movie opinions. They're like, you're incorrect. I just can't explain why. It's because you don't have any reasoning for it.
You know, I don't want to give that to you, but that was a fair assessment.
We haven't had anyone else two times except Soups.
I don't know. We'll figure it out later. So, how y'all doing? You drove from Orlando to Los Angeles. That's pretty crazy.
We did drive.
Yeah.
Flights are crazy right now.
But, and we're cheap. Yeah. But, you know.
And plus, we got to see family on the way here. You know, it was also a wholesome adventure.
We wanted an adventure.
Yeah.
And being able to see if I could stand him for that long in a car.
How'd that go?
We passed the test.
Unreal. As bad as we thought it would be, actually.
Good
no.
shit. Yeah. I love hearing that.
Still got the drive back to figure that out.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Yeah.
Sometimes I want to beat the shit out of him, but.
Yeah. It's mainly,
that's brothers.
Mainly towards the
or
end of the day.
Podcast co-hosts. And you happen to be
both. We're both.
Yes. Well, all right. So let's just jump right into it.
All right.
Shit. We need to grab the agree or disagree signs.
They're right here.
Okay, perfect. Cool. Do you have four right there?
Bam.
Andrew's a freaking professional. So
he's ready to go.
This is you. This is you. This is me. This is me.
Timothy Chalamet?
This is you. This is you. I hate him. You didn't know that?
No.
Oh, we know. I know.
He hasn't seen Doom because of him.
I haven't seen any Timothy Chalamet movie ever.
Oh my god.
Yeah, I haven't seen Interstellar. It's the only Nolan I haven't seen.
Everyone shut up except Garrett.
Hello?
Alright. I'm just making sure.
Good call.
I'm doing my technical...
Sorry. That is... If you ever see us looking over, we're checking cameras. If you ever see Andrew slightly just look...
We're a one-man... Two-man show.
Yeah, we don't have any help.
I got it. So, fine.
But we love you guys, and that's why we do it. All right, so we are doing agree or disagree. You've been on the pod before. You know how this goes.
Yep.
So I'm just going to start reading statements, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go. Revenge of the Sith is a top two Star Wars movie.
Three, two, one.
Disagree.
Agree.
Unreal. Agree. I expected this from him. This is ridiculous.
What's your number one?
Revenge of the Sith.
Wait, what?
Yeah.
I thought it was a clear number two.
It's just crazy. That's crazy.
No, I mean, look, say what you want, but I'll let nostalgia play into a factor. I'll let the nostalgia play into a factor. But it's Anakin's downfall that makes it for us, man.
There's so much about his downfall that's bad. Like, the actual turn is rushed. Like, in the context of the movie, if you don't add the 8 seasons of the TV show, if you don't add, like, all these books, like, it's just rushed. Mm-hmm. Him cutting off Mace Windu's hand in the context of the movie does not make too much sense.
I think it gets better as you rewatch it. If you notice the little nuances, I think it gets better.
I love Revenge of the Sith with all my heart. It's probably one of the movies I've rewatched the most in my life, but I just think we have to be honest that it's no better than, I don't know, one of the bad MCU movies. You know,
you think it's
the bad MCU movies.
It's better than Quantumania.
I would hope so.
How about Captain Marvel? Where would you put it against
that? It's better than Captain Marvel.
Okay. Then define a bad MCU movie that you're talking about.
Like one of the mid ones, like Doctor Strange. It's no better than Doctor Strange. It's no better than, it's a 6 out of 10. Like, we have to be honest. Like, The Marvels is clearly a better movie than Revenge of the Sith.
Wow. I don't know about that.
That's a strong take right there.
Yeah, I just, I don't understand the sheer adoration for Revenge of the Sith on the internet. Other than the fact that we all grew up with it, and you're right, we're watching it with nostalgia goggles. I've said this on the pod before, but I really think that, like, nostalgia plays, like, such a key part of, like, people loving a movie. But, like, when we're admitting what's good or not, like, we have to admit that Revenge of the Sith is not.
And we were just talking about nostalgia, too, and it's like, is that really such a bad thing, though, if it does play into a factor? Because there's a reason why it is nostalgic, is because it's good. Now, not all the time, but why not let nostalgia play a factor? Because it holds a special place in our heart for a certain reason.
That's literally why people love No Way Home so much, because it plays on that nostalgia
factor. No Way Home is also just a good movie, something that Revenge of the Sith is not.
It,
You could argue there's as many problems with No Way Home as there is Revenge of the Sith.
I think No Way Home looks like garbage consistently. I think that's the only problem with it.
How do you think Revenge of the Sith looks?
It looks, I mean, color-wise better, but there are some effects that are dated. It was shot in a room of just blue. So there are things that just look kind of shitty now.
Would have been better with the volume.
Would it have been? But like the scene where Padme, which admittedly, it's the best acting of his career, when Padme tells Anakin that she's pregnant.
Yeah.
Hayden Christian delivers legitimately a great performance because you see in his face, he's like dealing with all the emotions.
Yeah.
In that scene, it just looks terrible because there's a million columns behind them that just don't exist. It just doesn't look good. And there's just a lot of shots like that in Revenge of the Sith. I don't think that there are shots like that in No Way Home. No Way Home is just gray.
No Way Home just has like visually no sauce to it. You know what I mean? Now, from a technical aspect, I get you can have Empire Strikes Back be the number one Star Wars movie, including honestly with the original trilogy, because they did have to do so much with, you know, practical effects and everything, and new innovations with the visual effects. But I think too, it's just like a big thing for movies for me is the music, and that is without a doubt, the best soundtrack in the Star Wars movie.
I'll give you that. You can fist bump it.
The best Star Wars duel, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
The duels are a big factor of why we love those movies so much.
I will give
and
you
that's
the score.
Okay.
Revenge of the Sith has the best Star Wars score.
So many bangers.
It has Across the Stars. Yeah. It has Duel of the Fates on top of all the new stuff.
Yes. John Williams went ham with that shit.
Yeah, it's crazy that
there's not a single skip on that entire album.
Grievous speaks to Lord Sidious. A banger for no reason.
It's so good.
And then the opera comes in.
Look, I love Revenge of the Sith. I just, you know.
So it's your favorite. Do you think it's the most fun Star Wars movie? Revenge of the Sith?
When you talk about fun, I would go back between that and Return of the Jedi.
I was just about to say Return of the Jedi. Yeah.
Now, I think Revenge is like clearly more fun.
I think Revenge
is more fun, but I say it's like for fun movies, it's in competition with Return of the Jedi for sure.
I have Revenge at my third favorite.
Okay.
And number one for the most fun. The 20-minute opening is like...
You're not as much of a hater of Revenge of the...
No, it's not three. Well, I'm in fourth place. I'm not that much of a hater either.
I don't have a 6 out of 10 and say the Marvels is better.
Yeah.
So you got a 6 out of 10 at number 4.
That was a strong opinion there.
I am a Star Wars, like I don't know what else you would say other than fanboy. Like, Star Wars is my favorite franchise by a country mile.
Yeah.
Like, I love Star Wars with all my heart. Other than the first two movies... Every single movie has like clear flaws and clear issues. And the third best movie, I think, is Last Jedi, 8 out of 10. Like, clearly a step down from the first.
So you
two.
Probably like Dune better because they don't have any misses yet.
Well, that's what people say. Unfortunately, as a lead actor that I refuse to watch.
You can skip the 1984 one if you want.
That's what I've heard.
I wasn't even a Timothée Chalamet fan. Well, and I can admit that.
But you weren't a Timothée Chalamet boycotter.
No.
Why are you specifically boycotting?
There's a million reasons I've talked about a lot.
By the way, I'm supposed to be watching Haunting of Hill House, and we're talking about that because I lost.
Amazing series.
Yes.
Amazing.
We'll be talking about that next week. They're in town, so we're just doing an episode with them.
Exactly.
We'll come back to that.
Yes, we will. Ladies and gentlemen, we come with very glad tidings, we think.
Of nerdy joy.
We think.
Why we think?
There are some people that probably wouldn't rock with this.
Yeah, but the cool people will.
That's a good point.
You know what I mean? We don't have to worry about the lame people.
That's a very good point. So obviously the first two episodes of X-Men 97 came out this past Wednesday. Obviously, as we said on TikTok, I don't know if y'all saw this on TikTok or Instagram, we've seen the first three episodes. I think it might be the best project the MCU has ever done. You disagree, but it is very good.
Barely. I mean, the first three episodes are 9 out of 10, 10 out of 10.
Yeah.
Awesomeness. Yes. And everyone is excited. And when this podcast episode comes out, the first two y'all have seen, or if y'all have wanted to, and the third one's coming out in a couple days.
Yes. So we wanted to commemorate this being such a great project with a new piece of merch. We've got our logo, but stylized differently by the brilliant artist Drew Whipple. And he made it so that it's X-Men. So your mug is Cyclops.
Yep.
And my mug is the different colors of the new Magneto suit.
Yep.
And then the background, it's the X-Men logo. So
it's really cool.
It's really awesome.
Cool.
So
I'll pop pictures up.
Yeah.
But well, it's available now.
It is available now on our website. Unfortunately, we're not going to be shipping it until after the series is completed, so which is May 15th.
Yeah, so when the show ends, that's when they'll all start shipping out.
But you can buy them as soon as you want. They are available. And like we did with the last merch opportunity giveaway kind of thing, one random person that buys one of the hoodies, we will be bringing you on the episode after May 15th to discuss X-Men 97 with us. We'll talk about your favorite moments, what you agree with us, do you disagree with us, etc.
Yeah, so we're doing a couple things to celebrate X-Men. We're doing the merch, we're doing the come on the pod and talk to us about it, and then we're also watching every episode with you guys Wednesday nights at 5 p.m. Pacific, right?
So 8 p.m. Eastern.
Eastern. Mm-hmm. So each week we will be watching with you guys, and the merch is available right now. And then we'll talk to one of y'all at the end of it. And then that's also when it will always ship out. Also, we'll be doing that on the Discord. So join the Discord. This is like an announcement segment.
Yes.
So the Discord, we're doing a lot of stuff over there. Patrons will be able to come on and talk to us during the episodes. Mm-hmm. But everyone, it is available to watch for mm-hmm. anyone that is in the Discord. We're doing some fun things. We're doing a question of the day. I don't even know if you've seen this.
I haven't seen this.
We're doing a question of the day in the Discord that everyone gets to discuss. We're doing a fan of the week. And then fans of the week might get extra things like a segment on the podcast to talk to us, or their name on the set or something like that once a month. So lots of things happening in the Discord and on the Patreon. Movie nights. They've suggested Rise of the Planet of the Apes is one of the suggestions.
Oh, great. Great movie.
Narnia was on there. I think there's a couple different good ones. And then I just feel the community this month. The Discord's going crazy. The Patreon's going crazy. We're almost at I think we're at 468 or 469 patrons when we get to 500.
Yep.
We do a poll on what happens to my hair to join the Patreon.
Yes.
And then we've also got a couple events. I talk at the very end of this episode about potentially watching a Spider-Man movie in theaters. I'm doing a little Escape Pod with Fellow event for that, so stay tuned to the end of the episode to hear about that. And then we're also doing a trivia event with this restaurant. We've done one of those before.
Yes.
That's happening on April 27th, so if you're in the LA area, look out for those two things.
Yes.
All of that is happening.
Yes.
And we're also, in speaking of merch, restocking some of the blue hoodies.
Yes, the blue hoodies have been by far the most popular item, so we're bringing them back, and I've got some special announcements. When we bring them back, we are adding double XL sizes. By the way, double XL and triple XL sizes will be available for the X-Men hoodies.
Great.
And international shipping for the first time will be available for the X-Men hoodies and will be available once we restock the blue hoodies. So very, very exciting stuff. I know you guys have been asking for that a lot.
We're not sure if the blue hoodies will be available by the time this episode comes out.
They will not.
But keep your eyes, that is coming soon.
We will announce it when they come back officially.
One other thing before we go back to the Blake's Takes amazingness is we are doing a question of the week, and we will involve people on our socials. So we're going to ask you a question at home, and y'all will answer it in our Discord, on Instagram, wherever, on Twitter, on X. And we will read our favorite responses, either ones that we think are the funniest or the smartest or the best answers, ones that make, if you make us laugh, we'll probably read it, and we'll come back next week and give our answers to the question as well. So this week's question, hop in the Discord, hop into everything and answer, give us your answer, and we might read it next week, is, okay, but who would win in a Mortal Kombat tournament? And it is just a picture of all the Disney princesses. So you have Rapunzel, Mulan, Pocahontas, Elsa, Anna, Aurora, Cinderella, Brave, Merida, Tiana, Belle, Ariel, Jasmine, and Snow White.
Mm.
Give us your answers and check in next week to hear our answers, and we'll read some of y'all's.
YouTube comments also.
YouTube comments. And you did a Discord lounge the other night. You've been streaming on TikTok. I'm trying to stream on YouTube. I was in the Discord earlier today, just like editing and letting people watch and hang out.
Yep.
So, Patreon, Discord, merch, Instagram. We'll be talking about the events on Instagram, all that. So go check all that out.
And thank you so much for being such an important part of the community. I can't tell you how much we love you guys so much.
The fact that we're even able to talk about any of this and any of this actually makes sense is because people care about it.
Exactly.
And we care about you guys. So shout out y'all, and shout out X-Men 97.
And enjoy our longest episode ever. All right, so we'll just move on to the next agree or disagree. We could probably talk about Star Wars all day. I watched the 2024 Oscars.
3, 2, 1.
Disagree.
Disagree.
Agree. Yeah, what'd you think of it?
For the most part, I think it was one of the better Oscars that we had in the last few years.
What did you think about John Cena being naked?
I thought that bit was funny.
It was funny.
I thought that was funny, but...
We get to see John Cena shirtless. What's not to like?
Dude, his body looks like a little action figure.
It does.
I see what you
mean.
Yeah, you
could, like, take his arms off and his legs and, like, put him back
it
on.
It looks like it would not budge a single inch if you pushed any muscle on his body.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. No, but I thought Ryan Gosling carried the Oscars, honestly.
Just like he carried Barbie, too.
Yeah. No, dude, his performance for I'm Just Ken at the Oscars.
Great.
It was great.
I just watched
The energy was great.
And I am starting to love him quite a lot.
I have been a Ryan Gosling stan for a while. I've been trying to get people on the Ryan Gosling train.
Ever since La La Land.
Dude, Ryan Gosling over Ryan Reynolds. 1,000%.
I'm with you there. I'm 1,000%. With you 100% there. I'm with you 100% there.
1,000%.
But so about the Oscars, you guys just said you watched them.
Yep.
We obviously didn't. I don't know why he didn't. I straight up boycotted it. When I saw the nominations, everything, I was like, okay, you know, just look, I'm a fucking nerd. I get it. But, you know, no respect to superhero movies consistently. Spider-Verse not nominated for Best Picture. Boy and the Heron beat it for the Golden Globe, so I knew it was going to lose Best Animated, which is just ridiculous. No score nomination. I knew they were going to give Ludwig score,
of course,
which is fine.
Yes.
Just listen to the music, whatever that song is called. That song alone was going to win them a Best Oscar for score. Mm-hmm. But the Spider-Verse 2 score was iconic.
Yeah.
You heard those sounds everywhere. And to nominate John Williams for the 98th time for a very uninspired score, what are we doing here?
No, I completely agree. I think them not being nominated for best score was even a bigger snub than them not being in the best picture category, for sure. And I knew, you know, once I saw The Boy and the Heron win the Golden Globe, I kind of figured that they were going to give the Oscar to that. Now, being Miyazaki's last film, I also figured they would give the Oscar to The Boy and the Heron as well.
Did y'all watch The Boy and the Heron?
I did. I
didn't.
I wasn't the biggest fan. I know people, beautiful animation, but like I just couldn't get into the world that they were building in that movie.
Because it was pointless.
It was just like,
what were the little floating white things? Did that represent something?
Those were, yeah, those were the
they help people go to sleep or something. I don't know.
Well, and then they were souls, or like souls that were trying to get back to the real world as well.
Was the heron with the little goblin with the big nose inside of it?
Yes.
Was that like a normal creature, or was that something from another world?
Yes.
Where did all the other doors lead to?
Someone took
Batista,
some acid.
Dave Bautista voiced a very large bird that had like a cloak on. What was he?
Did he? I saw the Japanese.
I watched the other one.
The English dub. Yeah, I know I'm Robert so Pattinson was the heron. Yeah. But I saw the Japanese dub. Japanese audio.
I want to bring Chris on just so he can explain
why. It was his favorite movie of last year. So he was thrilled to beat Spider-Verse.
You know, I think the people that I've talked to that really loved it were...
I don't dislike it.
Right. There's just like the theme of grief, having to deal with grief in that movie. But honestly, I wish they focused more on what was happening at the family at home instead of going into this world that I just couldn't really get into.
Mm-hmm. So you thought it was a snub that Spider-Verse lost Best Animated?
I think Spider-Verse should have won
Spider-Verse
Best Animated.
100%.
But also, how many sequels have won an Oscar for Best, you know?
Does that matter?
Yeah.
It shouldn't matter.
I know, but how many?
Toy Story 3.
Toy Story 3.
Toy Story 2.
There's only like two or three sequels that have ever won. Return of the King.
Oh, just period.
Sequels. Yeah, no, period. There hasn't been many sequels that have won Best, you know, Picture or Academy Awards, period. That's why people are kind of stressed about Dune 2 as well.
I kind of felt it was more of a snub of the superhero genre rather than just like sequels.
Well, because TMT as well. You could say you should have been the best animated category.
Yeah, TMNT not being nominated also was frustrating.
I think you should probably just watch more movies.
I guess so. All right, we'll move on. This actually has to do with the last one. A superhero fatigue is setting in with general audiences.
3, 2, 1.
Agree.
Of course.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
And I think the fault is mainly Disney, honestly, with trying to pump, you know, 20 out in a year. Like, how can you get excited? You can't keep track of that. How can you get excited that many times for average content that you're going to keep releasing?
I mean, it's crazy that I'm like, I was one of the biggest MCU fans in the world. I've memorized multiple movies. Like, I was there opening night every single time.
Yeah.
It's literally our job, and we haven't even watched all the TV shows.
Yeah, no.
Like, what are you doing?
Dude, I watched, that was the same thing for me. Like, I was just as much of a diehard fan of Marvel. Like, I was so excited every time they were releasing a new movie in theaters, and I didn't even finish Echo.
No, I slugged through Echo.
Yeah, I didn't watch any of it.
Yeah.
Dude,
I stopped watching Secret Invasion after episode 2.
I got to episode 4.
Bro, yeah. You gotta watch. Dude, just for the laughs, brother, watch through episode 6. The last episode. Have you... what's the last Star Wars movie? Rise of Skywalker?
Yeah.
You know the moment in Rise of Skywalker where she's like, I'm all the Jedi. Okay, yeah. There's like a moment like that where she's like surrounded by ghosts and like Kingpin comes at her and she grabs him like Avatar Aang and like takes his,
bending away.
She takes, like, she like emotionally like solves his trauma or something. And he's like, what'd you do to me? What'd you do? And she was like energy bending him. It was the dumbest thing in the world.
What the?
Does she? I don't know anything about her in comics or anything. I don't even know if she has powers. Does she have? Oh yeah, she has. Palm thing.
And she literally is like in the last episode. She's like, and like, where all the ghosts are like,
and where the fuck did that come from?
No, she.
Where did it come from?
In the comics, she is like straight up reverse Daredevil. Like no, like crazy powers other than that. She's just like, her vision is exceptional in the way that Daredevil's hearing and smell and all that is exceptional.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because she's deaf, it's the same thing.
Cooler.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's so weird. Yeah.
I thought it was supposed to be more grounded. No.
Yeah, yeah, right? Exactly. It's supposed to be like this grounded crime thriller show.
Everyone was expecting some...
It was TVMA. I didn't really feel that TVMA aspect.
No.
That's what I heard.
No.
It's like...
Again, I didn't watch any of it, but I heard that the gunshot through the head, bottom of the head that we see in the trailer, they were like, that's the most
TVMA. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
100%.
No, it's like, guys, we're showing blood this time. So it's TVMA. We're showing blood.
Well, in the trailer, you see him like absolutely destroying that guy by the trash in the alleyway.
Yeah.
And like that scene's in there, but you've already seen that. And
yeah.
There's nothing else. Yeah. Everyone was expecting like a street level New York fight thing, and then they go to like Wisconsin or something in the first episode, and then they're there the whole time.
But I mean,
I think people were hoping for like what we saw in the Netflix Daredevil series.
Yeah.
Back to the main question.
What?
But I mean, yeah, just like, people getting fatigued with it. It is a lot to keep up with. And I mean, just like anything, you know, you live long enough to see yourself become the villain.
Yes.
You know, you see that with the New England Patriots, Kansas City Chiefs, any dynasty, you know, the hat MCU guy. Dynasty.
Yeah.
Hat guy. You know, we see them become the villain. No, he's having a hero. He's having his redemption arc. He's a hero right now. And you just, you know, you want something fresh and new, and you don't, you know, these movies like Barbie and Oppenheimer, that was such an amazing time to go to theaters, even with Dune. Yeah, you needed to see part one to appreciate it. But again, it's just like, it's a new, fresh story in theaters, and like having these IMAX experiences as well, it's just, that's where you need to fucking be. It's amazing.
You know, I liked the statistic he pulled up about like how most movie sales were for those individual movies, not like a franchise, like, you know, when Marvel was at its peak.
Yeah.
It's very interesting. Very, very interesting. All right. You ready? We reacted to the trailer today. The Acolyte looks great. Keyword is great.
Okay.
3, 2, 1.
Disagree.
It doesn't look bad.
Right.
But there's nothing in there that was like, oh.
Yeah. Right. No, right. Nothing in there got me super hyped.
Let me tell you, I was disappointed initially watching the show because I thought it looked bad. I thought it was shot on the volume, everything like that. But as you texted me earlier, they have confirmed that none of it was shot on the volume.
Yeah.
Which makes me happy. I don't mind being wrong when I'm wrong. Like that makes me happy.
As soon as I saw that, I texted him.
The shots just look bad. But that's fine. There was a shot on a beach that looked really good. And I've since rewatched the trailer. And I will say, the scene at the end with all the lightsabers, very Knights of the Old Republic.
Yes.
Right.
Which are some of the best lightsaber fights we've ever seen. So I'm very interested. We will see. I hope it's not bad.
It's just different. And I'm excited.
Which is good.
It's a different timeline. It's not. It's going to give us something fresh. Hopefully it's
good. However, it doesn't look great, but Echo looked great. The first
trailer was
great.
Yeah,
you can't really put too much of your chips on trailers, you know?
No.
Yeah.
However, I do want to point out, just because the Knights of the Old Republic fights that we see, especially like the video game cutscenes, beautiful. Some of the best fights we've ever seen. But I wouldn't even refer to that as like what to expect from this. Because it's clearly something totally different.
Absolutely not. But just seeing all those lightsabers at once, I was like, oh.
Yeah. It just reminded you.
From my youth.
Yes.
I want to throw a lightsaber through a forest and just cut a bunch of trees down.
Everyone says those games are amazing.
Yeah.
They are.
Darth Malgus, bro. Oh my God.
Revan's from those games.
Yeah.
A lot of great characters from those games. A score of a movie can be the best part of the movie.
3, 2, 1.
Agree.
I mean,
okay, we're all scoring.
I mean, 1,000%.
Well, it can be.
Yeah.
I'm not saying it normally is, but like, say a movie is absolutely terrible in every other way, a la Cars 2, but some of
the score,
but the, some of the score is fun.
No, score, yeah, I am the score guy. That is probably the top two things I do look for in a movie. I know Garrett is more, you know, he's got the writing aspect of it down. That's what he's looking for.
I'm looking at the story. Like, the story, does the story make sense?
Not to say I don't want a good story. I do. Yeah. But I'm saying I love looking at cinematography and the score. And I think the score can just really take the story to another level because it's another way of telling that story. You know, taking you along on that journey.
No, go.
By all means.
Okay. Well, the question was, a score can be the best part of the movie.
Yeah.
And you immediately mentioned bad movies, but the score is amazing. There are plenty of examples like that. Attack of the Clones.
Yeah.
Let me change it. A score can be the best part of a great movie.
Three, two, one.
Agree.
Technically, agree. Still, yeah, it's yes. possible. Yeah.
I think Empire Strikes Back, I love that movie with all my heart. I think it's a 10 out of 10. I think the score is the best part of that movie.
Okay. About to cook. I have a question. When enjoying a movie or liking a movie, you just said the score can be the best part. Mm-hmm. What is the most important part about a movie that you need to enjoy it?
Probably not the score, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
But the score can be a important factor of liking a movie mm-hmm. or thinking a movie is good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So what are some of the other things that are at the top of your list, like this needs to be good in a movie, or if something else is like average, but this is good, I can still like a movie. Does mm-hmm. that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Because
mm-hmm. some people act like a few of these things are important and nothing else is important.
Mm-hmm.
But I think all of it can be important and some things are more important to other people. So what do y'all think is most important to like about a movie?
Mm-hmm. No, that's a good perspective. I mean, obviously, like writing, mm-hmm. like, you know, if you have, you're so beautiful. It's okay. Only because I'm so in love. Like if you had that in Revenge of the Sith, right? You're getting down a point because that's not how people talk. That doesn't work for me.
Yeah.
Right. Visually is a big thing for me.
Yeah.
If a movie is shot on the volume, like Thor: Love and Thunder, and it looks like garbage because it was shot on the volume, mm-hmm. I'm going to dock you points. On mm-hmm. top of Thor: Love and Thunder having all these issues, it just looks like garbage.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Other than the black and white scene, which looks amazing.
Yeah.
So that's true. A movie has to look good for me. It doesn't have to be, you know, groundbreaking, you know, the best cinematography I've ever seen in my life.
Like Dune.
To be the best, like, you don't have to be a great movie if you have that, right? I think No Way Home's a great movie. It looks like shit. But No Way Home rises in other things. I think a movie genuinely has to entertain me in some capacity.
Yeah.
And entertain can mean a million different things. I'm not entertained watching Schindler's List, but I am enthralled.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I am, like, intensely watching it in a way that I'm not, you know, Killers of the Flower Moon.
Yeah. What about y'all?
You go. Take this one. I'll go too.
I would say believability of the acting performances is definitely, that's going to be a big one sure. Okay. Yeah. Acting, I would say acting, set design, mm-hmm. and music. Yeah. I would say those are like top three. Yeah,
that's great.
And
I mean,
that's tough.
Besides, I mean,
have the same answers.
Besides music, but like I think having a good character as well. Like when someone can find a character they can either relate to or just are very enthralled in, really helps out a lot. Even back to the writing, like how this is how people talk. Like I think that's why Quentin Tarantino movies are so beloved because he's such an amazing writer. Like, yes, these are how people talk in real life, you know?
Like some of the conversations, like people always go to the Pulp Fiction conversation where they're literally just like eating food and
Royale
talking.
Royale with cheese.
Yeah, the Royale with cheese. And then also like they were talking about, he's like, why don't you eat pig? And he's like, I just don't dig on swine. It's a dirty animal.
Yeah.
Like, it's just the most random conversation, but it just shows you what kind of character mm-hmm. that person is. Honestly, anything that just makes the world seem more believable, that's what I'm going to consider, because I don't want to think like these are actors acting, this is that person.
And believable when it comes to certain movies and on pen and paper, because I, you know, over the years you realize too how important, and this goes to kind of set design as well, how important lighting is. Lighting is so important in a movie. And you know, sometimes we don't need such realistic important lighting. Like give us just some sauce in that lighting that makes it feel like another world, that we're just, that, you know, we go to the theaters to kind of get out of our reality for a little bit. And I think that can help us just, you know, dive into another world as well.
So as I was saying, As I was saying.
Are you saying something to me?
Yeah, and everybody.
I'm grinding Marvel Strike Force. I'm not really interested.
Our sponsor, Marvel Strike Force, is apparently really fun.
Honestly, really addicting. I just unlocked, I unlocked Luke Cage. The character I have the most fun playing with is Deadpool.
Mm-hmm.
Punisher's a lot of fun.
Do you know our promo code?
Max Pool.
Oh, nice work. As we speak, Marvel Strike Force is enjoying their 6-year anniversary. What does that mean?
It means they're giving away a lot of stuff.
Yeah.
I'm playing every single day because every single day I'm getting new stuff. It's great. They're very generous. It's like a turn-based RPG. It's like a lot of the games I played before, but to be honest, Marvel Strike Force probably my favorite. I'm having a lot of fun playing it. And let me tell you, something underrated that not too many people are going to tell you about Marvel Strike Force, they really nailed the character design.
Good.
Every single one. The Punisher suit is incredible.
Costumes good?
Yes.
Nice.
They're so good.
Go check out Marvel Strike Force. We have a link in our description. Use our promo code. They're giving out stuff each week, so come back each week and complete, you know, events and
every
things like
single
that.
Day you play, you get a new gift from Marvel Strike Force.
And
they really will reward you for consistency. And it's a whole lot of fun.
Are you glad I'm not playing?
What's that mean?
Can you not play other players?
You can play other players.
So you have to be glad I'm not playing then.
I would destroy you.
You wouldn't have any fun in the game.
You would have a team of entirely leveled down Spider-Men.
And I'd still beat you.
Chris Pratt is a great voice actor and deserves the roles he gets. Three, two, one. Agree.
Agree.
Disagree.
I'm fine with either of these answers because you said great. Mm-hmm. I think he's a great actor.
Mm-hmm.
I don't necessarily think he's a great voice actor,
yeah.
But I think he's good, and I think the hate that he gets for his performances and the fact that he's chosen for these roles is wildly blown out of proportion. Like, he's chosen for a reason. Like, mm-hmm. obviously he has the stardom power that brings mm-hmm. people to the movie.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Which is part of why he deserves it. Mm-hmm. And I don't think, I've never watched one of his movies and been like, that was a bad performance.
Right.
Like, they've always been.
Voice acting performance,
yeah.
specifically.
Yeah, 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 specifically. Yeah. Especially normal acting. Like, yeah. Guardians of the Galaxy 3, I thought he killed, right?
Yeah.
Like, everyone, like, jumped on the train of hating him for Mario. And then when the movie came out, like, I was interviewing people at Comic-Con mm-hmm. about this that loved Nintendo characters. And almost all of them were like, I'm just going to wait to, like, a lot of them were like, I'm going to wait to see the movie. Like, when the second trailer came out, they were like, oh, it's not that bad. And then when everyone saw the movie, it was like...
Yeah. Yeah. If it okay. was yeah. the classic yeah. voice, it would have annoyed the shit out of me.
No, it probably would have been annoying. I was not mad at the Mario performance at all. But...
Now he's Garfield.
Now he's Garfield. That one seemed odd. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
Again, it's not, you know, we're not saying he's not great, you know.
That's literally the question. I'm saying
he's saying that.
Yeah. I'm saying he's not great, but he is good.
Yeah, that's fair.
It's just for me, he is Hollywood's straight man to just get a regular voice.
Yeah.
He's a big star, so they're like, oh, whether or not Chris Pratt moves the box office needle.
Yes.
You could certainly argue he can. You would certainly argue he can't. But whether or not Hollywood thinks he can, so they're going to always get a straight man for that and whatever. And at the end of the day, something that a lot of people forget, before Guardians of the Galaxy, before Jurassic World, he was Emmett in the Lego movie. He was a voice actor in his first big box office movie before Guardians, before he was a big on-screen star.
Yeah.
People knew him as the funny guy from Parks and Rec.
Yeah.
And he was Emmett.
Yeah.
So, like, it's not like voice acting is not his wheelhouse, technically.
Right.
True.
It would be like, you know, giving The Rock a ton of shit for taking over the wrestling scene again.
Yeah.
It's like, what? His roots. What are we doing here?
I think. Sorry.
Yeah.
I think it's because Emmett was like an original character, and now they're casting him with characters where people have like a vision of what they should be like, and that's where they're getting annoyed. They're like, because he's not a voice person. Like, he doesn't switch it up. It's literally just him.
Yeah. No, I understand a little bit of the hate and being a little bit annoyed because he is getting a lot of those roles like back to back to back. I just think the internet. I said agree mainly because the internet likes to jump on things and overhate right. it, and I yeah. think y'all need to chill the F out.
Right.
Like, you're acting like it's the end of the right. world, and then when people actually go to see the movie, it's like, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
They people just overreacting.
Yeah. That's fair. Awkwafina is a great voice actor and deserves the roles that she gets.
Three, two, one.
Disagree. Yeah!
Disagree.
No!
I'm going to just do it for the switch out.
Oh, we hate Awkwafina in this household.
I don't hate her.
I do. Sorry. I hate Awkwafina.
I don't. I haven't seen enough of her stuff to have a strong opinion, right. so I'm going to tell you a backseat on this one. But
I just personally don't like that voice that much, and that's just a personal thing.
Yeah.
Like, a lot of people who are making these movies think that voice fits characters well, and those characters are just annoying to me.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the way they're written and because the voice fits that annoyingness. Mm-hmm. So I guess I agree in the sense that she's nailing the annoyingness of the character, mm-hmm. but that's just the way my ears work. I just don't necessarily like that voice that much.
Mm-hmm.
I need to see Kung Fu Panda 4 before I can...
She's not awful in it.
Not awful.
It's her best role of her okay. career.
What would you say are her worst performances that really piss you off?
Riot. Oh, Shang-Chi is the worst. She is so bad in Shang-Chi. Oh my gosh.
Did you see The Little Mermaid?
I refuse. I saw the scene where she rapped.
Oh my gosh.
It made me want to die.
Oh.
Raya, the last dragon.
It wasn't that bad.
She's the last dragon.
Mm.
I think she was kind of annoying in that, I think.
Yeah. And then
that's a voice acting performance.
You don't hate her in Renfield, and you don't hate her in Crazy Rich Asians?
No. She was fine in both.
I think she's annoying. I haven't seen Renfield, but I think she's annoying in Crazy Rich Asians. But again, like, it's not as bad as like Shang-Chi.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think it's the same thing as Crazy Rich Asians. I think she's not as annoying in Ocean's 8, but I still think she's annoying.
I also think it's just like a personal preference thing. Like, obviously she keeps getting these roles because some people find her funny.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And some people find her voice entertaining.
Yeah.
And it just doesn't hit for us. And I think for a large portion of viewers, yes. I think she's very polarizing.
Yeah.
And to more power to you if you enjoy it. It's just not for us.
You guys are content creators. You'll like this. Sorry, this is if you feel left out about this conversation, we're sorry. But this is really interesting because I've been talking shit about Awkwafina since day one. Like, our first episode of the podcast, I said she's one of my least favorite people on the planet. I hate her. But, like, for the longest time, we've been posting these clips on social media, on TikTok, on Instagram, of me hating on Awkwafina. And they always, it's people like, yeah, Awkwafina really? Sucks. Right. But very recently, we posted a clip. It was actually a repost. It was a post we posted previously of me talking shit about Awkwafina.
Yeah.
And everybody was like, fuck you, Awkwafina's great. And out of nowhere. And then we just posted another one of her being slightly likable. And it's very 50-50.
Really?
Interesting. You know what?
I got like a million views.
You know what? I think that what you have for Awkwafina on this show is like what Korra is for Garrett on our show.
No kidding.
Oh, absolutely. Like, we had one video recently where Garrett went on a Korra rant again.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
And
Positive or a negative Korra? Right?
Negative. Always negative. Negative. Always negative for him. And the top comment was like, thank you, we are here for the Korra hate. And I had like 60,000 likes, just that comment itself. Yeah. But then other people are like, well, I don't get the hate for Korra, yada, yada.
Korra's very polarized.
Korra is the most, bro, people will like post edits of Korra like she's about to, you know, fuck up every other avatar that's ever lived. I'm like, are you joking, bro? Are you joking?
Well, we have a lot of Korra prepared, so we will save it.
Save it for that, but yes, I'm going to fucking take
off.
But
it's interesting because we are the exact opposite of you guys with the Korra spectrum. Like with our audience, every time we talk shit about Korra, people kill us.
Really?
People absolutely massacre us. We get tagged. So the thing we get tagged in the most is Cars 2 stuff.
Yeah.
We get tagged in a Cars 2 post a day.
Yeah.
Pretty maybe 5-6 times a day. Also every day, we get tagged in a Korra post, and it's like, how do you like Atla better than this? And we're like, what? What?
No.
I'm fine. I've come to realize that, you know, some people are going to like Korra. That's fine. It's not for me.
No,
I have
100%.
My reasons for it. However, if you say that Korra...
However, brother.
What's up, brother?
Is it my turn?
If you say that Korra is better than Atla, I need you to seek medical attention.
That's pretty crazy.
That I will not allow in my circle of friends.
No.
Yeah.
Wow.
No, you can... I don't care if you like Korra. That's fine. I'm going to stick to my opinion. But yeah, if you say it's better... Something is wrong, 100%.
They are doing Zutara in the live-action Avatar show. Not whether or not it's a good thing, but they are doing it. That's the agree or disagree.
Okay.
Oh,
Zuko and Katara are going to get together.
You think they're going to do it?
Do I think it's
going to
happen?
Right. Do you think it's going to happen? Not whether or not you like it or not. Okay. Just do you think that's what they're doing?
Okay.
3, 2, 1.
Agree. Yeah.
Agree.
Agree.
Well, that's crazy. I mean, it'd be pretty ballsy for Netflix to do that after I sent them a threat to firebomb their offices if they do so. That's a joke. Please don't arrest me.
I haven't seen a single romantic hint between Katara and Aang. I could 100% see them doing that, especially, and I think they're going to get weirded out about the fact that Aang is 12 and she's a little bit older.
And you got to look at, too, the chemistry with the, you know, the live action actors as well.
Yeah.
I could see the chemistry just... You know, just being there.
I could see it happening.
For them to do it.
100%.
And they've changed something, so...
Yeah.
Why not?
We've talked about this a little bit, but...
He looks so sad.
They made Zuko really nice in likeable, this season. Likeable,
yeah. Yes. Really likeable.
And yes.
I think it's to prepare people.
Yeah.
Hey, I wouldn't...
And I already think that this universe is clearly not canon to the animated.
Right.
Because... Bumi's such a fucking asshole. There's no way you're naming your son Bumi.
No.
There's no way.
No.
Right? So they're already changing things like canon like that. Like,
No, honestly, I think with the stuff that they did change in season one, it's just going to keep spiraling into other changes because certain things happen because other things happened in the past. And yeah, I think this could definitely be a rolling snowball effect.
You don't think they're going to do it, Andrew?
You know, it's one of those questions where, like, even if you have evidence for something, you can't allow yourself mentally to go there because you will never be able to get yourself out of that hole. You know what I mean? Like, I can't let myself go there. Hey, Aang hasn't waterbent at all either.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah.
He's going to become a waterbender.
That's
so, like, they can still do it. They don't even have to do Katang, which would be stupid.
See, but here's the thing, though. It's going to... If they do Katang now, with like the lack of development that we've seen in season one, it's gonna feel.
They got two more seasons,
but you've already done.
It's gonna feel forced.
You're past fortune teller. You're not doing fortune teller.
You
didn't have her lose the necklace, so you didn't have the kiss on the cheek moment.
Yep.
You didn't have him being infatuated with her. When he met her, you did Cave of Two Lovers as brotherly and sisterly love.
Yep.
These are huge moments.
Every romantic instance is gone. It's gone.
Yeah.
No, I could 100% see them doing that.
I will get my firebombs ready.
Please do.
Hat guy should just shut up and watch Dune.
3, 2, 1.
Disagree.
I
Blake's cooking. Blake, what's your reasoning?
Blake, you're saying
Hat guy should shut up. Yeah, sorry.
Dummy. Can you read?
Yeah. Fucked up.
I was so ready for him to be like,
oh my God.
Stand your ground.
The biggest Dune advocate.
I know. I always fuck up with this once.
Can you read the statement again? What was it?
Hat guy should just shut up and watch Dune.
I would take out and watch Dune and still agree.
All right, nice, Andrew. All right, we'll just move on.
Yeah, he should watch Dune.
No, you're literally depriving yourself of an amazing fictional universe.
On three, can we do a hat guy watch Dune? 1, 2, 3.
Hat guy watch Dune!
That was loud.
It was needed.
You'll have to force me.
Well, you cheated twice in the trivia challenge, and a lot of people want a rematch for that, given that you are a bum.
It's so good, man. I have no response.
We did a trivia challenge where if I won, he had to watch all the Dune movies.
Yeah.
There's only two.
And he would have had to watch Interstellar.
Well, three.
And because I lost,
he's literally in it for like not even a second, bro.
So he, knowing this, came up with a wonderful little trivia challenge the week prior that if I lost, he would get an advantage in the trivia challenge the next week, which would determine Dune. And obviously, he rigged that so I lost. So he got an advantage.
They were very hard questions.
He got an advantage going into the trivia challenge. And then there was a rule that you had to buzz and answer within 3 seconds. He buzzed and took about 10 to 15 and got a point for that. So, you know, if you want to cheat, you can cheat. You know, I wouldn't expect nothing less from Hat Guy. Watch Dune.
I won fair and square.
Speak.
Okay, dude, I would say the Dune fictional universe is 100% on par with Star Wars.
Now, a lot of people aren't going to agree on that.
No, not everybody is going to agree on that.
And I don't think he's going to like them.
Right.
Very much.
He's going to really?
Especially because we're hyping them up so much. I don't think he's going to like them.
I don't think
there's any way that I give the second one less than a 9 out of 10 from what I've been hearing.
Right.
See, but...
I think it's better than Star Wars, and I doubt I think it's like the best movie ever, but like...
Agreed. I don't think you're going to... You know, hop on the train that much, but
I love the world building in it. I really do.
Next,
we'll see.
And he is Timothée Chalamet.
Superman Legacy, which is now retitled The Superman, will be the highest grossing movie of 2025.
I don't freaking know what else is coming out that year.
Yeah, I know. Things got delayed.
Yeah.
Everything's gotten delayed.
Everything's
gotten
delayed.
Avengers: Kang Dynasty was supposed to come out in 2025. As of right now, it's not. Fantastic Four is currently set to come out in 2025, but we don't know. There's a lot of stuff coming out in 2025, but it's just generally a question about Superman Legacy more than everything else.
One.
Disagree. Wow. Oh, Andrew, wow. Please tell us why.
Because I can't think of another movie that's coming out that year.
All right, solid.
Okay. So I think Beyond the Spider-Verse will get delayed probably till 2025.
Yeah.
And yeah, no, yeah, it definitely is. I don't think it's going to beat that.
Though.
I don't think it's going to beat Superman.
Yeah, Spider-Verse 2.
It didn't do as much as I thought it would.
500 million.
I thought it was like 700. It was like 700. It was like 700.
Continue. Give me your text.
I simply think that the fact that Henry Cavill's not in it is going to drive away a decent amount of the fan base. Mm. I'm not sure. Mm. But I think that is going to play a factor because people love Henry Cavill as Superman. Yeah. So
I think I will say, though, I think 2025, it is going to give people enough time to get over the DCU and Henry Cavill. So it's like, all right, restart. Fuck it. So I don't know. It, you know, I mean, yeah, it's the biggest name in comic book history, so it's got a chance.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. And if it is great, I could see it. But no James Gunn-directed movie has made $1 billion.
Has any Superman movie made $1 billion? Has any Superman been the highest grossing movie of its year?
I don't think so.
No.
I don't know about...
Maybe the original.
Of its year, I would believe the older ones, right, the Christopher Reeve ones.
Maybe.
But I don't think any of them have cracked $1 billion.
Because the original was, 1976? I believe so.
They're old, brother.
Yeah. I think it was 1976.
They're old, brother.
It's around the 70s, but I don't...
Because if that's the case, that's I would say yeah.
That's true. 78.
Damn!
I knew it was 76. God,
Blake, you suck, man.
No, I don't.
Yeah, you do. He was close.
Movie year's my shit.
But yeah, so we'll see.
We'll see.
But we're rooting for it. Hopefully it's the best movie ever. The several month break in the middle of season 2 of Invincible killed the hype around the show.
3, 2, 1. No.
Agree.
Okay. Disagree.
Why?
Are you not hype? I'm hype.
I haven't watched any of it yet.
Me neither.
Same.
You all sucked it.
But I felt like everybody was talking about it week to week when the first four episodes. Like I was having to dodge spoilers. The second episode of the second half of the season comes out tonight. Nobody's talking about it.
I don't think it killed the hype. I think the hype is still there. I don't think they've done a good job tapping into it. I don't think they've done a good job letting people know that it's out, but I think the hype is still there. I think people want to know how that story ends. The first half of that season was so good that people were like, frick yeah. As soon as I heard that it was out, I texted Zach. I was like, we got to freaking watch this.
But you haven't.
No.
But I'm going to. I have plans to. It was not a... I don't care about it anymore. I still care about it. It was just a lack of knowledge. The question wasn't did it kill the knowledge of it coming out. It was the hype. Did it kill the hype? It did not kill the hype.
The hype is 100% killed. What are you talking about? Dude, every single video that I have watched talking about the second season
is
how it killed the hype and how this is literally just a money-grabbing decision made by Amazon so they can include ads.
The ads are new now.
Let's go. No. It's a good show.
And they freaking strung people along for how many months so they can release the second half? Oh, and the And the decision to release the second half so long later is it changed five times.
Here's the thing. Granted, they do this in like sitcoms and regular TV shows, especially like back in days, you know, but four episodes.
The
season's only 8. Wait,
you gotta digest it, you know? You gotta digest it. It's just too much. It's just release it.
Season breaks all the time.
That's what I just said. I agree. Bullshit. I agree. But those were episodes of seasons of TV that were like 20 episodes.
Yeah.
I mean, Breaking Bad, 13.
Four.
Right.
4 episodes? Are you kidding me? After we waited so long for a fucking season 2?
And Breaking Bad has its reasons too for doing that with like the last season of Better Call Saul. So that with Breaking Bad especially, because they put them on Netflix after season 4. Everyone started loving it. It was all right. More
Dude,
time.
Part 2 sucks because we had to wait 5 years.
No,
we didn't. We waited 3.
That was way too long.
I was the biggest.
We were waiting 3 years between Star Wars.
Avatar Way of Water sucks. We had to wait from 2009 to whatever the frick.
I mean, it's not.
I wasn't a fan of it.
It's not as good as the original, but.
Whoa!
It's the same story.
It's the same story.
Avatar Way of Water is like, okay, this is the original. Avatar of the Way of Water.
You're hilarious.
No, it's just the same hilarious. Story.
It is so much better on every level.
Every level?
Back it up to Invincible. Frick you.
Okay. No. Dude, I was the biggest.
Have you watched the first half of the season?
Yes. I was the biggest. Dude, I was the biggest advocate for Invincible.
He has been.
I was like, Blake. I was like, Blake,
watch this. Watch the first half of the second half.
Yes. I was like, Blake, watch this show.
And you don't care about the rest?
I do care about the rest. Don't get me wrong. I am going to watch it when all
the hype is still there.
No. No, I am not as excited to watch it because I am pissed about their decision.
You have to wait 3 months?
Yes!
That's baby mentality, brother.
It's not.
That's baby mentality.
It's really not. I can't be pissed at Amazon for wanting to be money-grubbing whores.
How is that? You can't whore out Amazon because
they
wait 3 months.
Yeah, you can. Oh, you can.
Why?
Yes.
They are the biggest whores.
Don't call Amazon a whore.
I'm still going to use it all the time, but.
I haven't watched any of it. Because I haven't watched the first 4 episodes of season 2 because I really enjoyed watching season 1 all 8 episodes in a day.
That's
so that's what I'm doing for season 2.
If the new season of The Boys comes out, I'm like, all right, intermission. I'm like, fuck, really? Yeah. I want to keep watching.
Y'all's attention spans.
Attention spans?
Yeah, I think you just need to work on it.
Oh my God, excuse me for getting mad that I'm not getting fucking content for this show that I already waited 2 years for.
Yeah, we did.
You can't wait 3 more
maybe
months?
Even longer.
We waited so fucking long for this second season.
I'm pretty sure Invincible was pre-pandemic, right?
I think it was 3 years.
Dude, it was so long. You're telling me I wasn't patient enough already?
Other than you being... Okay. Impatient.
And No.
Explain the ad thing to me. You better explain the ad thing to me if you're going to whore out and you're going to call Amazon a whore.
It's a new thing. They did do that.
Yeah, they...
I just want an explanation.
So now, for the same price that you were paying for your Amazon subscription... Okay. but for your same price that you're paying for your Amazon subscription, now you have to watch ads and you have to pay more if you want to have no ads.
This is correct.
I blame Biden.
And they literally used...
Inflation. That's not Amazon's fault. Inflation. They're
really
good business model.
Really
good business model.
Why are you defending Bezos? He's not going to give you any money. I don't know why you're defending Bezos right now.
How do we feel about television not having seasons every year now? And they're like, it's getting pretty normal to wait 2 to 3 years. Thankfully,
the bear.
The yes.
Bear. We're getting a bunch of shit.
Yes.
Do you care if if a show comes out weekly?
No.
No.
Why? You gotta wait a week between each episode?
That's fine.
Frick that.
That's a week.
That's normal TV.
So long.
It's a week.
For this TV show, I'm not waiting every week.
It's a TV. Week, not 3 months.
That's normal TV.
But then you get four episodes at once.
No, we don't.
It's week to week.
It's week to week.
Darn it.
Yeah.
I'm effed.
Yeah.
No, I just don't think it's a big deal. If the show is good, the show is good. That's all I care about.
And see, it is a good show. What bothers me the most, though, is that they literally said everything was done.
Yeah, they said it was finished, finalized,
completed, and they're just withholding it. That's what really pisses me off. It wasn't putting the finishing touches, because then I'd be like, okay, yeah, I want it to be perfect when I watch it.
Also,
but you fucking finished it, and you're just holding it back.
Are you kidding me?
I think you're slut shaming. I think you're slut shaming Amazon.
The hype would have been unreal, because then you have the last half of the season, the finale coming around during the holidays. Everyone's at home chilling on the couch. Dude, hype would have been real.
Yeah.
Now you got Dune in theaters. Everyone talking about Dune and everything. The hype train is down.
No, it is
still
down.
An amazing show.
Other shit has replaced that hype. Right. It's not the only thing being talked about.
Has the first 4 episodes of season 2 been at the level of quality of season 1?
Because episodes 3 and 4, yes.
I think season 1 is a 10 out of 10 show.
Yeah. No, it's
season
perfect.
Season 2 is just as good.
It is very good.
Yeah, it's very good.
Very, right, very good.
We'll move on. That was fun.
That was fun.
Henry Cavill's Superman should be explored more in DC Elseworld stories.
3, 2, 1.
Disagree.
Yeah.
Let it die.
Yeah. No.
Let it shrivel up and die.
Yeah. Look, and that's, I love Henry Cavill, right. But you can't you can't have multiples of these characters.
Yeah.
When it was talked about how, Gal Gadot was gonna come back for as Wonder Woman, I was like, bro, pick one. You can't continue the old DCEU and start a new one at the same time. I'm like, kill
except
it.
Except season 2 of Peacemaker.
But The Batman. What do you have to say about The Batman continuing while simultaneously we're getting a DCU
Batman?
That
wasn't part of the DCEU.
No, it wasn't part of the DCEU. Okay. It was a completely separate thing.
Yeah, I'm only asking that because you said you can't have multiple iterations.
No, no, no. You
characters.
Can have multiple. Yeah, just like you can have multiple Marvel projects. Like you had the X-Men and then you had the MCU. Like it was different.
And then people know that.
And people know that and it's established. But if you're going to bring somebody from the DCEU into your new thing, but you're saying it's a completely new thing, you're people would get so confused. Be like, is this a completely different Wonder Woman?
That's a little too confusing.
Yeah, no stress.
I love Henry Cavill, but just at this point, we gotta let it go.
We're gonna have a No Way Home moment with like all the Supermans.
Literally, yeah. I mean, we tried that in Flash. Yeah, yeah, I was about to say, they kind of did with Flash.
Flash was so good.
Pokemon is an S-tier franchise.
Can I abstain from this?
Yeah.
Nope.
Oh. I have zero opinion.
So then you would disagree?
Just, okay.
Three, two, one.
Agree.
I mean, just based on...
I don't have much opinions on Pokemon as well, but just the fact that like...
How well known it is.
Yeah, look at the name brand. Right, look at the name brand.
All right, for that fact alone, then yes.
So recent. If you look at like the biggest things in fiction, like Superman, DC's been around since the 20s. Mm-hmm. Like Scooby-Doo's been around for forever.
Yeah.
Star Wars has been around since the 70s. Like Marvel's been around for forever. Mm-hmm. Like all these things. Pokemon came out in the 90s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pokemon.
Like you predate Pokemon.
Of course I do. Pokemon is like the highest grossing like franchise ever, first of all. But also, like, they came in and they were like, oh, card games? Yeah, we'll be the biggest one in the world. TV shows? We'll crush that too.
Yeah.
Video games?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll conquer
that. We're going to give you the same game every single year and you're going to buy it.
Does Marvel have a card game that even rivals Pokemon at all? No. Does it have a video game like that? No. Does it have a TV show like that?
No.
I don't think so. No. Like, yeah, maybe movies like... They haven't had like a Hollywood blockbuster other than Detective Pikachu or whatever.
Right.
And I'm sure they've had a lot of animated movies, but like
they don't even need it, man.
Yeah, like Pikachu is.
You can walk around and show someone a picture of Pikachu. They're probably gonna know who fucking Pikachu is.
Mm-hmm. No, it is like
even
probably one.
I've never personally experienced it. Yeah, you gotta. Yeah. You
there
respect.
Was a there, the show Who Wants to Be a Millionaire.
Yeah.
Somebody was asked the question, "What color is Pikachu?" And he had no idea. It was blue, red, yellow, and green.
Wow.
He had no idea, so he had to phone a friend, and he was like, "What color is Pikachu?" And he goes, "Yellow." And he goes, "You seem very sure of that. Like, are you sure?" And he's like, "Put yellow right now." He was offended that he was asking him again.
That's so funny.
But that's how it is. It really is.
Yeah.
It's the amount of people that don't know who Pikachu is, every year it lessens by hundreds of thousands of people.
You know, you would have to live under the biggest rock in the world to not know who Pikachu is.
Yeah.
Who was I piecing up? Someone was playing Pikachu the other night and I was crushing him. Okay, I just
wondered. Shut up. What are you talking about? I was pissing him off bad with the Pikachu lightning.
It's so annoying.
Because the lightning wraps around the map, and so you can't get back up.
Annoying because I have to deal with you. You alone, I would destroy you.
Yeah.
I deal with you and then Zach charging up the Bowser kicks. I'm like, I can't do anything. I can't. Like, he's playing like an idiot. You're playing like an idiot, but I can't punish either of you.
This guy. Dude,
he's a problem.
No, he's a
his
problem.
No, he is a pyromithra.
I am telling you, there was like a 90-second stint where like I was on the bottom platform and he just went and just like jumped around up top, and I was like, "Come down here, fight me like a man."
And we will be videoing, recording us playing Smash, and that'll be on the Patreon. So if you want to see this rage,
no, there's plenty of it.
Yeah,
Stock King.
The stock, dude. Blake's out here.
Everyone on the stage has one stock. He's just over there in the corner with three stocks, walking around, dude.
40% is crazy.
We're like, can we get this guy off the stage?
The MCU Fantastic Four cast is great.
Three, two, one.
Disagree.
Yeah, cash, fight me.
What do you love about it?
Here's the keyword again. Here's the keyword.
He's the only agree.
Right, but keyword great.
Yeah, keyword great. So. Yes. But let's hear great. Why great?
Are they all professional actors?
Yes. 100%.
Excellent.
I feel like it doesn't really take much to define a professional actor at this point.
Ooh.
You're cooking.
Yeah.
You're cooking.
Is Dwayne The Rock Johnson a professional actor? Yes.
Yes, but
Does he have a good acting ability? Not really.
Would you like Dwayne The Rock Johnson as Reed Richards?
No.
Why not? I love it.
Because he doesn't fit that character in the slightest.
Correct. I think the four characters that we've gotten fit them well enough. Frick you for not calling him hot enough. He's freaking sexy.
Joseph Quinn is not hot enough.
Joseph Quinn is
sorry.
A god.
Nope.
They'll make him look hot enough.
Will they? Like, I get that he's hot.
Stand on set.
I get that he's hot. Like, I'm not saying Joseph Quinn isn't hot, but he is not conventionally attractive. You have to get, like, the hottest guy ever for the Human Torch. Yeah. That's just a part of his character.
But then
again, why they had Chris Evans.
Bro, is
Chris Evans and Michael B. Jordan. Like, I don't even love the characterization of those two characters, but like, you nailed it. Like, you cannot get Joseph Quinn.
It's 2024. They're not going to play on that. You know that, man.
But that's like ridiculous. Like, that bothers, like, they just, there are key things about each of these actors that bother me, with the exception of the Thing, and I love that he's Jewish.
I love Ibon.
Ibon
is fantastic. He is so good.
Jewish.
Love him in The Bear.
But like Pedro Pascal, look, if you want to tell me he could play anything, because he is one of the best actors in the world, no problem. You can sell me on Pedro Pascal being a cocky asshole, even though I've never seen that. Fine. You could sell me on that.
Right.
And I get Vanessa Kirby is a beautiful woman, and she's a great actress, and this and that. But Sue... Like, Vanessa Kirby, what do we know her from? She was Napoleon's wife in Napoleon, sophisticated European, right? What is she in Mission Impossible?
Bad point.
Sophisticated European. So everything. Everything I've seen, she's in The Crown. Sophisticated European. Everything about Sue in the comics is she's the all-American woman. She should be from Wisconsin. She should be American as fuck. And I get that British people can play Americans. Tom Holland does a great job of it. Like we see we see it all the time, but like, she looks like a sophisticated British woman. Does she not?
I mean, actors, though. Yeah, man, I don't know.
And I think you're forgetting that, you know, like, makeup and shit exists.
hair and wardrobe.
Hair and wardrobe. Role. I don't like it. I don't have anything that makes me not like them, and I'm sick of, like, prejudging people based on not enough evidence. People didn't like Heath Ledger as the Joker until it came out.
That's correct.
Right, yeah. So I'm not going to say that they're not great or they're not good before I see them.
See, you said, I don't know. I think you can say something's not great before.
That's fine.
Yeah.
That's fine.
Like, you can say they're good but not great.
Sure.
Like,
sure.
I don't think I would ever agree to this statement until I saw evidence that they were great.
See, but here, great point. Right, great point. But the thing about Heath Ledger too is he was playing the Joker, right? The Joker is just behind makeup and hair. So I think it gets tricky too when we are, you know, you cast all these actors as previous IP characters, comic book characters, it gets a little trickier. Like, yeah, we're not going to know, but...
There's just been so many great roles where people have killed it,
right,
where people immediately were like, oh, this is terrible. And I am just taking a stand against that because we haven't seen it. As soon as I see them in a trailer or see them in the movie, then I will judge them. I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt.
And I will say...
You're optimistic, he's pessimistic.
MCU, if anybody has been good historically at casting, guys, you wouldn't think for this role... Like, the MCU has done a tremendous job with casting. It is the one thing that they have to be commended for, I think, the most.
Yeah.
And I will not stand for the Joseph Quinn is not hot enough. I am ready to drool over him, as is the rest of the world.
He's not a Stranger Things fan.
What if they don't, like, have him, like, beef up or anything like that? They just, like, have him be, like, a hot music guy or something like that. Like, that's his attractive factor.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
We'll see.
I'll retire.
We'll see.
This is a two-word statement. You ready?
Okay.
Korra bangs.
3, 2, 1.
Disagree.
Cook.
God.
Next. Yeah. Do I need to expand any more on that?
Do you have any more Korras?
Yes.
Yeah. Let's continue.
No more agree or disagree, but we have another Korra thing.
Right, we're going to get an entire Patreon episode out of this as well.
Okay. Yeah.
We're already at an hour.
Okay. Oh, really?
Is that okay, gentlemen?
Yes, fine.
Thank you. We love you. Godzilla Minus One deserved the Oscar for best visual effects.
Ooh.
3, 2, 1.
I will remind everybody of the nominees.
Yes, please.
Guardians of the Galaxy 3.
Okay.
Mission Impossible.
Okay.
Napoleon.
Okay.
And The Creator.
Agree.
I thought there were many shots where the Godzilla did not look good. But that's just me.
I think with that win, they were taking into account the budget, especially, that they were working on. Sure. Which... So I can see why you'd be upset because, yeah, that budget restriction is probably where those shots probably lacked.
Right.
But I think they were just taking all that into account. Like, with what they were working with and the fact they made it look that amazing.
I am so happy that that movie won an Oscar.
Right.
It was my fourth favorite movie of the year.
But yeah.
Like, and again, did you guys see Zone of Interest?
No. It's so hard to find a screen in that movie, man.
It's a painful watch.
Right, yeah.
I don't have a problem with that winning best foreign film.
Yeah.
I would have given it to Godzilla. I also probably would have.
But I don't even think that was up for Best International Film.
It wasn't?
It wasn't, no.
It was nominated for something else, was it not? Or it was only
I think it was. Right. No.
Well, I'm happy of winning the only Oscar it was nominated for. But okay. It's just.
Yeah.
Like, for that.
I picked the creator to win. I'm glad Godzilla Minus One win, just because, like, we are sick of seeing these $200 to $300 million movies.
Yeah.
Specifically with Disney.
Yeah.
That just. Don't look good.
It's crazy.
And the innovation that they use for Godzilla Minus One is
not
just,
you're obviously Mission Impossible looks incredible. You're not getting that best visual effects. It's just Tom Cruise jumping off of a fucking mountain.
Yeah.
Which is sick.
Yeah. They need a stunt category. What? Yeah.
So this is a
stunt needs to be a category.
There's so many categories that need to be categories. We need best voice acting. We need that. Mm. We need best, like, I don't know how you award it, but the fact that Andy Serkis is Oscar-less is a travesty.
That's pretty crazy, yeah.
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 Best motion capture performance.
I know you couldn't do that because aren't that many a year.
Yeah. Right,
but like, Benedict Cumberbatch for Smaug.
Have you seen the videos of him doing that are like my favorite thing on the internet. He's like on the ground. He's like,
yeah. It's
like,
awesome.
like there's so many like motion capture performances that are so damn good.
No, you're
okay. So this is a discourse on TikTok. You know, Letterboxd going up to actors and being like, "What's your favorite four?" Mm-hmm. And like a lot of the American actors or English actors are like, "La Nuit La Raison from like 1941," and everyone's like, "What the frick are you talking about?" And then they asked Godzilla Minus One creators, the four of them, and it was like. Okay. Back to the Future, Blade Runner, like Empire Strikes Back, Jurassic Park, and it was like everyone was like, "Hey!" And like some people were like stitching that and being like, "These are movies that you should like or whatever."
Yeah.
What do y'all think about being annoyed at people for like picking like
so
pretentious films
real quick,
as opposed
real quick,
to?
Yeah. I'm gonna let you finish because we've never talked about this on the pod.
Right.
Because it's very controversial because people are very upset about the jokes that people are making.
Yeah.
Like the people where it's like, "Oh, you ask a pretentious film bro his Letterboxd top four," and they're like, "It's actually a French film. It's 9 hours.
This 9 hour like, black and white."
Like people are getting mad about that because they're like, "Fuck you, we have taste." Like the film bros that they're making fun of are getting mad about that. Obviously, we have been on the other end of the spectrum with that. So
when?
I'm not necessarily upset about them getting upset, but I will say to the Godzilla Minus One people, Jurassic Park, Blade Runner, Back to the Future, those are obscure foreign films. Just saying.
True.
Just saying. Those
true.
Are.
True. No, 100%.
It's a time travel movie from the 70s that, like, it's a guy.
80s.
And That is. Yeah, it's from another country. It's American.
No, I don't know. I don't think Jurassic Park is as obscure
It's not. But like,
I know what you're
saying.
Going from. It is a foreign film.
It is a foreign film.
Like,
to them.
That might be the pretentious pick.
I don't think it is.
It's not pretentious.
You gotta remember that America owns the film industry in a lot of areas. So like our films are known worldwide.
The film industry in Asia is huge.
Chinese film industry is huge. But I don't think I see what you're saying, but I don't think it would be like a pretentious pick to like these American films.
No, I'm not saying it is. I just pointed that out.
I think everyone is just able to like what they want. I personally am kind of roll my eyes when people are saying films that no one's ever heard of from 100 years ago and that's your favorite film. But like that's going to be them. Like, I'm not going to pick that.
Yeah.
I loved when I saw the Godzilla Minus One people picking movies that were like actually entertaining to the vast majority of audiences and actually like could still inspire.
Mm-hmm.
Like I'm personally going to like that better when I see people liking those kinds of movies, but I'm also not going to like tell the other people to frick off.
Yeah.
No. Like, you know what I mean?
In response to that, what is everybody at the table's Letterboxd top four? Do you have them off the top of your head?
Yeah. Oh, I probably could.
No. Yeah.
I was just thinking about this.
Go for it.
The Avengers followed by The Greatest Showman.
Of course.
About Time and Emperor's New Groove.
Cool. Okay. Interesting. La La Land, hands down.
Yeah.
Number one. Halloween.
Mm-hmm.
Hang on. So I would say also, you know, it's funny because all my top four Letterboxd favorites is Dune 2 right now, just for the hell of it.
Oh, that's really funny.
Okay, so La La Land, Halloween.
This man was like, "Yeah, I've got him."
I know, right?
You know, I think I'm just gonna go.
No, go.
And to be honest, I haven't updated this in a while. Yeah. But when I made it, Django Unchained.
Yep.
The Dark Knight.
Yep.
Shawshank Redemption.
Bang.
And Across the Spider-Verse.
Bangers.
For
me, it's Star Wars: A New Hope, 1977. Across the Spider-Verse. War for the Planet of the Apes and Parasite.
Bangers.
Okay.
Bangers.
So yeah, La La Land, Halloween, Suspiria, which is an Italian horror film.
Yeah.
Oh, this isn't just a-hole.
Yeah, right? But again, it's just like...
Is it black and white?
That Halloween and Suspiria in particular really just opened my mind up to the horror genre because I was not a horror fan when I was younger. And those two movies is what really opened my mind to the horror genre. Now my favorite genre, and just love the giallo style Italian horror movies that we get from Dario Argento that are just amazing. The set design, the music, the lighting, beautiful. So just those two in particular just really have opened my mind to the horror genre. Mm-hmm. Number four, it's always a switch up, man. Like,
what's most recent? Is it Dune?
Yeah.
You just keep it
in honestly, Dune, man. Oppenheimer. I love Oppenheimer.
Everything Everywhere All at Once is like just out of my top four. Okay. So that could
you could do Oppenheimer, Dune, Jurassic Park. Like,
would it be Dune part two or one?
Part two. Yeah. I still love part one. But it's just like the fourth one is always so hard to pick for me.
What do you guys feel about your Letterboxd? Because this is a popular thing and this is something that I follow. What do you think about your Letterboxd top four? Even if you do have two movies from the same franchise,
yeah.
You don't include them in your top four because you want to show your variety.
100%.
Because no question about it.
Yeah.
Empire Strikes Back is probably my two.
I was wondering.
Probably New Hope, Empire, and then the stuff. But I don't want to put two Star Wars.
I get what you're saying.
What do you think about that discussion?
I always, because growing up, I would always have conversations with my dad and my family. But like, if you got to go to a desert island and you can only take four movies with you, what are you taking?
Yeah.
I'm taking a variety. I'm getting a Star Wars. Yeah. I don't want to take two Star Wars. I only could watch four movies ever again. I'm going to take a Disney animated funny cartoon. I'm going to take About Time because it's a deep emotional thing. And then the other two. Like, I have a superhero movie. I have Greatest Showman. So it's a little bit of a variety. That's how I think.
Yeah. I totally agree with that. Because, if you just flood the list with, you know, your favorite franchise, then, like, what are you left with?
What are we taking if we want to bring a comedy? Rush Hour.
Great.
Yeah.
Or Rush Hour 2.
Dude. The Rush Hour movies couldn't be.
What do you guys think of The Other Guys? Right. Have you seen it?
Yeah, of course.
Sorry.
No, you're good.
Best Will Ferrell movie.
Yeah. No, it's so great. I agree. It's so great.
Continue.
You got any more?
Yes.
Wait. Oh, shit. I was going to say something. I think
you've forgotten
no
stress.
I might have lost it.
This is the last agree or disagree.
Okay.
We should get a sequel to the Snyder Cut in comics form.
3, 2, 1.
Agree.
Let it shrivel up and die. Anything with the Snyderverse.
Comic. Yes. No. That's what.
Give us closure.
No.
Y'all can have it. That's fine.
Let it die on screen. But I mean, if people want to continue to follow it, just let them in comics.
Start a Kickstarter.
Let it live.
Yeah, I would love a comic. And comics used to be events. Because of the movies, they're not events anymore. That comic would be an event.
Yeah. Awesome. Snyder fans. All right. I like Snyder.
That's agree or disagree. We can put all these away. Thank you, gentlemen. And I just got a real quick segment after this. We're not doing a bracket.
Yeah.
really? This is would they die or would they survive?
Okay.
I'm going to give you a scenario. I'm going to drop a character into a situation. And you got to tell me if they would achieve what I'm asking if they would achieve. Would they just survive? Okay. Would they kill the president? Would they, you know, whatever scenario I'm giving you. All right. You ready? Okay.
Got it.
Captain Jack Sparrow needs to save the world in the world of Tenet.
Nope.
The villains are using the Tenet stuff. Jack is going to be guided and helped by Robert Pattinson, and the villain is Kenneth Branagh. Does Jack save the world? So he is the protagonist in Tenet. But it's Jack Sparrow.
Yes.
I don't think so.
You don't think he could drunk walk his way through?
No. I don't think
Here's
so.
Here's the thing. I think because he gets a little creative when he's trying to plan, trying to solve some mysteries.
He can be creative. I don't think he'd be that creative.
When he was in Davy Jones' locker and he just starts running back and forth on the boat to get to the other side and they start catching on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is creative.
Yeah, I think he does.
He licked a rock that turned out to be a crab.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. Yeah, and the crabs moved the boat.
When he was dead.
Some of the greatest plot armor we've ever seen.
Okay, are we taking plot armor into account?
That's like, you to assume.
Who's directing this movie?
Does he have access to rum?
Ooh.
And Robert Pattinson knows the rum he prefers, and it's not the rum he orders.
He can do anything.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm thinking.
I think he's got it.
I do want to see a reverse.
Reverse drunk walk.
Have you seen my Jack Sparrow run? I think I nail it.
You're doing well?
Yeah, I'll show it to you.
Oh,
after.
Shit. All right, we'll do it on the Patreon.
All right, y'all are getting me a little bit more on board.
So Jack is surviving.
I think Jack
the world
does it, man.
All right.
I think,
I'll give it to him.
We've done a variation of this on this segment before. Every Jedi versus a billion lions. You've got roughly 10,000.
10,000 Jedi?
Mm-hmm.
Jesus.
Like, okay, how good are these Jedi?
Doesn't matter.
You've got Yoda, but then you also have younglings.
Oh, dude. Okay,
I need like a percentage here. Scene.
Mm-hmm. With the March of the Temple music,
you gotta consider.
But it's just bro, the younglings,
like some of the greatest masters. Sorry.
Continue. No, keep going.
Sorry, no.
No. Dude, I need like a Yoda to youngling ratio here. Like, cause if we got 10,000, how many of those are younglings? That plays a big factor.
There's like a billion.
So there's younglings. There's Jedi Knights. The Jedi Masters, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
So let's say there's a third of each.
You need to
No.
There's more. There's less masters.
So let's say 50% is. Let's say 80% are younglings and knights.
Whoa.
So oh, okay. you got to consider some of the greatest masters and knights they sent to rescue everybody on Geonosis, and they got decimated by battle droids. But you also have to consider there were not a billion battle droids, but you also have to consider the battle droids have blasters.
Yeah, no, blasters are a big part of that.
Battle droids were effective because they came in there numbers, and we've never seen a billion.
Yeah, there's not a billion droids. Mm-hmm. There's not a billion droids.
A billion lions?
Yeah, I'd probably give it to the lions.
They just force push them away.
I think I think they could spread the battle out enough. So they have lightsabers, which is a one-hit kill mm-hmm. on every single everyone.
Even the younglings are going to kill some lions.
Yeah.
They're going to get tired, though.
Yeah, they are going to get tired.
Fatigue is a factor.
Yeah.
I think it comes down to just like the top of the top Jedi. Like, is Yoda ever dying to a lion? I
don't think so.
Also, whoa, hang on.
See, and they can, also use the force to increase their longevity though and like not get tired.
Do Jedis want to kill the lions?
Yeah. No, they don't give a shit.
This is a death match.
Yeah,
yes,
they don't give a shit.
Match. Yes, we're taking morality out of it.
Do we get the Mace Windu from the Clone Wars movie?
No.
Darn.
You get canon Clone Wars.
Dude, because he was effing up some. He would eff up a billion lions by himself.
There was a 2002 animated.
Oh, yeah, no, I know what you're talking about.
Mace Windu just takes on like a
whole army by himself. It was so dope. Like, I want more stuff like that. Let him be overpowered. I'm taking the billion lions.
You're taking the billion lions?
I think I'm taking the billion lions.
You're taking the billion lions?
A billion's a lot, brother.
It is. And there's no question that the 10,000 Jedi, the firepower, is less than one of every Pokemon. I'm taking one of every Pokemon over every Jedi.
Oh, I'll take I'll take Pokemon all day.
Yeah,
on that one.
Or maybe not. Humans do enslave Pokemon.
I kind of want to go Jedi, honestly.
Then go Jedi.
I want to go Jedi
over the billion lines.
Yeah, I want to go Jedi.
It's tough. All right, next one. So you're going lions.
Yeah.
You're going lions.
Yeah, I'll go lions.
You're going Jedi.
What are you going?
I try and be impartial here.
Oh, man. I see.
I think I'd go lions. I just, they lose to so many great Jedi get killed by droids.
Yeah, bro, but Blaster 66. They all died.
Yeah, they all
like 5 seconds.
Yeah. How many of them died in spaceships though?
A lot of them survived.
Yeah, and also blasters. Blasters. Yeah, this is all melee fighting.
Okay,
they can use the force to keep so much distance.
But they get tired.
Okay, let's say, what was her name? Isla Secura died in that little forest thing. How many things did it take to beat her?
12.
Okay, so how many lions would it take to take down 12 clone troopers?
Probably 60 to 200.
Okay, you have a billion.
Yeah, you've got like, more of that to spare.
Yeah.
Right, you've got to consider a billion is 1,000 million, and you have 10,000 Jedi. So there's 100,000 lions per Jedi.
I think I'm more impressed that we're just making this a valid argument right now in the numbers.
Well, it's all about math. All right. Huh. The League of Super Pets versus the Avengers of Earth 8311, which are the Avengers that are pets. They're animals.
Run me down the Super Pets.
Crypto's
soloing.
Soloing.
Yeah. So too. Yeah. No, I'm going the DC one mm-hmm. for sure.
Okay. This is one I have an opinion on.
Okay.
Kyoshi, Roku, Aang, and Korra versus Prime Anakin, no limbs cut off, full potential. He's like 40 years old. No limbs cut off. Prime Anakin.
I'm going the Avatars. I don't know. I'm going the Avatars.
Like, full potential Anakin.
Bro, Kyoshi.
Oh, yeah, Kyoshi.
Kyoshi has. I considered leaving her off, but I thought it'd be too much in Anakin's favor.
Yeah, no, Kyoshi's a monster.
She's the strongest one, I think.
I'm going Avatars too.
Whoa. Yeah. Watch, he's going to go Anakin.
So I am going Anakin.
Yeah.
I would like to mention some feats, right?
Let's hear it.
The gods of the Star Wars universe.
Oh,
is in Clone the Wars. Father, yes. The son, and the daughter. Yes.
Yeah.
And he, not prime, with an arm cut off. Right, your metachlorian count is based on its cells in your body.
Yes,
right.
Yes.
So it's based on how much body mass you have.
Yeah.
We're giving him back an arm, and with an arm missing, easily all right, subdued.
Arm. It's more a hand. Okay, come on. It's not like he
it's
got cut.
This
at,
down.
He didn't get cut at the shoulder.
Okay, but it's this down. I'm giving him back this down. That many cells. That much more metachlorian count. I'm giving that back to him. Also, years and years and years of training under both Sidious and like the Jedi's, and he subdues easily the sister and the brother.
You have to remember, on that planet, his power was highly accelerated.
Absolutely, it was enhanced.
Yeah.
But I'm assuming that he can get to a state more powerful than that easily.
See,
after 20 more years of training, you, also having all
you
his
say things. All these years of training too, studying under Sidious. You got to remember all the years that the Avatars have on the, under the
absolutely.
Belt too. So
absolutely, yeah.
I'm going Avatars.
But how strong is the Avatar state?
Fucking strong.
Very strong.
Compared to the Force.
I think strong.
Two questions. Can they blood bend him? And
that's
can they,
my
and
question.
Can they metal bend his lightsaber?
Ooh. And
whoa.
His arm. Oh, wait, no.
Yeah.
I will give you metal bending his lightsaber. I'm going to say that he's going to pretty easily be able to block their mental capacity to bloodbend.
Okay.
But, but Aang and Korra can both metal bend?
Yes.
Don't forget the energy bending, too.
I don't
which
know.
I mean, well,
but
that's
that, dude, you cannot dude, remove the force. Dude. You cannot remove the force. You cannot energy bend him to remove the force.
Bro,
and I thought about it. Can he? They subdue him with the earth the way that they do with Amon's dad, mm-hmm. or the way that they do with Ozai.
Yeah.
Like take him like that. I don't think you're going to be able to do that to Anakin.
Bro,
he's so strong.
Kyoshi, bro, she literally moved. She made a fucking island.
I'm with you.
Maybe like, if you said Starkiller, I don't know. Maybe it would have been a little interesting.
No.
However,
Prime Anakin is so much stronger than Starkiller. Like it's not a conversation.
Does Kyoshi have
he doesn't get his limbs cut off?
No.
So he's Prime Anakin.
They can cut off his limbs, conceivably.
Yeah. Oh, I'd love to see Aang friggin'. All right.
Yeah.
Can he shoot lightning, and can Aang redirect it?
He can shoot lightning. Aang can redirect it.
I'm that alone. I think that's gonna give it to the Avatars.
He's never faced that.
No.
He has no idea that's coming. He's going to be Ozai when he shoots it at Zuko and is like, what happened?
Yeah. Yeah.
And Aang.
I can't. I just like the power level of the Avatar universe. I don't think it's the power level of the Star Wars universe.
You're also giving Anakin a lot of like asterisks.
Right.
Like, you're changing the amount of limbs he has.
Yeah.
You're changing his entire storyline to let him like...
Well,
yeah,
because obviously like, they're killing Darth Vader. Obviously they're killing Palpatine. Obviously
you're
they're
creating
killing
a whole new character here.
Like, you're like, he's making Anakin like Legends Luke Skywalker, who's like almost a god.
But like even Legends Luke Skywalker is not Prime Anakin. Like,
I understand
Prime,
that.
Prime Anakin.
The Prime Anakin you're
the MCU.
The Prime Anakin you're describing doesn't exist in canon.
I know, but like
just in our hearts.
He's making up an Anakin.
I am, but like I'm like you got that's the strongest character to ever come out of Star Wars is the potential Prime Anakin. And that's just what I'm saying. And like the strongest character ever. So are we all in agreement that Anakin beats any of the Avatars individually?
Yes.
In the individually 100%.
Okay.
But
yeah, we can make
but the individual. Fact that you got four masters of all elements with the Avatar state.
Roku defeated a volcano. Kyoshi created an island by herself.
Roku
she
lost
an
that volcano.
Island. She created Australia because she wanted to. Like,
yeah.
they can do stuff.
Shit. And especially I'll go Avatars if you replaced Korra with Yangshan. I'll go Avatars if you replace that.
Yangshan's a problem.
Yeah.
But I couldn't because I need a water one.
Oh, okay.
So I would give it to Kuruk and Kuruk.
No.
Kuruk.
No. If you threw Kuruk.
Honestly, it was one of the stronger of the four we picked.
Dude, honestly, Kuruk maybe replace. I would say replace Aang with Yangshan, but honestly, Aang's lightning redirection is a powerful ability.
And Aang, like I know he was 12 and he was taking on he was almost 1v1-ing the most powerful firebender to ever exist.
Yeah.
At the end, Aang, he was he was the youngest person to ever like master airbending. Like he's got a lot of feats.
Mm-hmm. And I will say, I would say like bloodbending is the closest thing in the Avatar universe to like someone using the force on you to like, you know, move you somewhere. Like would the Avatar state overcome that? Because we saw in Korra when he was fighting,
Amon's dad.
Yeah, I always forget his name.
Good.
But he goes into the Avatar state to overcome the bloodbending. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, would that help against the Force?
I believe it would. Because I do think Anakin is faster than all four of them. And I do think that, like, the Force does give you the capability to snap somebody's neck like this. Like, but I didn't say that.
Yeah,
because I think the Avatar state would prevent that.
Yeah,
yeah. Mm. I think a bunch of Star Wars nerds are definitely going to go straight for Darth Vader because like the potential for him is like there's no cap.
It's limitless. Right. Yeah,
but like I'm trying to think like if you have all of them attacking at once and one is metal bending his lightsaber away and one is redirecting lightning at him. And
yeah,
two are like earth bending.
You could overwhelm him. I think
they and they're all in the Avatar state at once and they all have like connection to like spiritual force level powers like energy bending. Even if you're not allowing it, I feel like there's a way for them to like get past some of the force stuff and overwhelm him.
And
for sure,
yeah. And also, this is also under the assumption that all the Avatars have access to every single element.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
And like, there are, in the comics and stuff, there's, like, spirit bending, where, like, you can tap into the spirit world and bring some of that power into the real world, or, like, bring spirits in, and, like,
yeah.
There's ways to, like, kind of neutralize the force.
I think all the Avatars using every single ability that they have to bring down Anakin could do it.
All right, and last one, real quick, because we talked about it yesterday. Iroh. Ozai.
Iroh.
They believe Iroh strongly. How do you feel, Mr. Just said that Ozai was the strongest fighter I've ever seen?
I'm pretty sure I said one of.
I don't think
I'm not so. Sure. I'm not sure.
Instant replay? He's dealing with the crickets. I have crickets in my fridge.
Iroh.
Whoa.
Wow. All right. 3 for 3.
Right. I don't think we can confidently say either.
No, I don't think we can.
And not confidently, but I believe Iroh.
Yes. Yeah.
There's just too much stacked up for...
Invented lightning redirection.
Exactly.
Studies every other element so he can get a better understanding of...
Cooking.
You know, just everything.
That's what I'm saying,
yeah.
Dude. Yeah. He's traveled the world.
Learned firebending from the true masters.
Yep.
Like, he's just a well-learned firebender.
You're taking the words out of my mouth.
I think is gonna...
Yeah.
Oh, I think that's gonna pay off against Ozai, who literally just relies on rage and power.
Dude.
And that's all he's got.
Exactly. Yeah. Iroh has traveled the world. He has learned from every culture. He has experienced different ways of bending, and that has influenced how good he is at firebending. And by the end of the show, he's gotten into physical shape. Everything about him is at peak at the end of the show.
Yeah.
And Ozai is just... back in the Fire Nation being racist. Like, he's not, like attempting to open his mind to different ways of bending. Yeah. I think he's going to get cocky. I think he's got the Azula gene of thinking he's better than he is. He does that with Aang and isn't expecting him to get into the Avatar state. He loses that. Mm-hmm. I think he's going to go into the fight thinking he's got it, and Iroh is going to pull out something he's never seen, a la the lightning redirection, and he's going to lose.
Well, he did see that from Zuko,
right.
But still, he doesn't know that Iroh can do that.
And Iroh can access the spirit world.
I was about to say, Iroh has a strong connection to the spirit world. But overall, just like, he's way more connected than the Avatar world. There's just no way that Ozai is going to overcome all of these feats that were named for Iroh.
You know, and I'm calling him out. Eris Quiñones, I don't know what you're talking about saying Ozai is going to win that fight. And I know you're going to bring... And he brought up in a video. I've been wanting to respond to this for a while.
And shout out to King Lion for agreeing with us.
Yeah, no, but he brought up...
It was a poll?
He brought up the quote of Iroh saying, if I were to fight my brother, or if I were to be Ozai, and I'm not sure that I could... Iroh is like literally the most humble guy.
Yeah.
The most humble guy. And I think he has another motivation of saying this so that way, you know, the Avatar gang isn't going to rely on Iroh to do that. Like, he's trying to convince them to do it.
He knows it's not his destiny.
He knows it's not the way to end this war. Like, he wants them to figure out a different solution.
He never says that he can't beat Ozai. He says
no.
He's not sure that
he
can.
He says he's not sure.
And he's also humble. Like, yeah.
No, I genuinely think he was not. He was just wasn't selling himself.
Yeah,
it's Iroh.
All right, solid work today, boys.
Yeah,
a lot of energy, a lot of focus.
Woo!
And
what about the Korra hate?
Yeah, start hating on Korra. Go ahead.
You have the floor.
Oh, I don't know.
Just randomly gonna start.
No. I've said my piece on Korra.
You and I are the same on Korra. I've seen 20 minutes.
Right, yeah. I don't have a huge stake in Korra.
Yeah.
But what I've seen, I don't think it's good.
Why?
Because, like, everything I see, I'm like, oh, yeah, these characters don't interest me. I don't like where they've taken this world.
I was very thrown off by how quickly the technology advanced in the cities.
Yeah, we talked about
we posted that on TikTok. Yeah. All of the responses were, look at the technological advances that we made in 30 years, like America. And it is crazy
that
we went from fucking the Wright brothers.
Right, yeah.
Flying that plane on the beach to the rocket in like 60 years. Crazy.
Yeah. But it's not like, look, it was probably more realistically in the Avatar world, like the 1600s or something. I don't know. Yeah. And then look at the advancements that were made from the 16 to 7. It was almost like
ancient civilization. Right. Yes. Yeah.
And like, it's a big thing where it's like, we live in a world grounded in tech. We live in the real world.
Yeah.
We live in the real world. So everything in our world has rules.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's no weird mystical stuff going on.
Yeah.
If you say you could only bloodbend on a full moon, that's a weird mystical thing that you can't really change in 30 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because you got to look at all the cultures that those nations were inspired off to and the time periods that those inspirations were. It was like, way before.
And I also did like what you brought up. It's like, okay, now if we, you know, make another sequel after Korra and we have a different avatar, we're going to be in the fucking present at that point? Yeah. Are we going to have our avatar on fucking Instagram? Like, I don't want to see that. Like, that's going to totally take me out of the world of Avatar.
Avatar is going to be on Tinder.
No, literally, like, bro, I just
went into the Avatar state today.
Oh my God. All right, I'm just going to go down my list of shit I do not. All right. So, and for those of you who think I'm like ignorant to Korra, I literally went back and rewatched the first season, and I will agree. I think I was a little harsh on the fighting. I think there are some good fights and good fight choreography, but the punching fighting that I was talking about, that mainly is in the pro bending fights. But I feel like Korra translate that a lot to her, you know, fighting in the real world just because she's like getting so used to it.
Yeah.
But I hate that she connected the spirit world and the physical world. Totally took out a very unique aspect of the Avatar, being that bridge. Mm-hmm. Absolutely hate the fact that she's losing just about every fight. I feel like she's never the hero, bro. I feel like she is never the hero. Like, you know, she escapes or in like, and you know, I thought the whole point of her, you know, already having mastered three elements was to, you know, show that she's like kind of a badass.
Right.
But why is she losing all the time? She's losing all the time. And even at the end of season one, here, like, she gets her bending taken away. Disastrous move as an avatar to get her fucking bending taken away. And who's the hero in the end? Aang! Who comes in and
just goes...
Yeah, and heals her. And, like, she did nothing.
My boy
Aang. And she didn't even kill him on. He escaped. and had Tarlok not did what he did, who knows what other fucked up shit he would have done.
Yeah, they got away at the end.
They got away. They were on a boat speeding into the ocean off in the sunset. But Tarlok was like, we deserve to die.
Yeah.
But, yeah, no, I just... There's so many things I just don't like about it. And then, the giant, like, spirit battle with, you know, an evil avatar. I don't know.
They made some choices.
I'll tell you what I do like. I like the comedy. I think the comedic effect. I think they have good timing with that. Like, Bolin is one of my favorite characters in there. Even Tenzin is really funny at times.
J.K. Simmons crushing
it. Anything J.K. Simmons does is amazing. And then what else do I like?
Everything I've seen from the show that I've liked is all Tenzin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Almost all of
them. And then the villains.
The villains are cool.
The villains are good.
The edits of Tenzin talking as J.K. Simmons, but it's quotes from Whiplash. Have you seen these?
No.
Where he's like, he's talking to Korra. He's like, if you don't get that out of my effing face right now.
That's so funny.
Dude, it's so funny.
Yeah.
It's so funny.
I've not seen
the fucking menace in Whiplash.
But,
I've still never seen Whiplash. Oh, you have?
No, I have.
Oh, okay,
I saw it within the last 6 months.
Yeah, recently. Oh, wow. So good.
It's amazing.
The endings. So one of the best endings.
You hate TASM too.
I don't hate it. It's just like the worst or second worst Spider-Man movie.
And out of 10?
Maybe a 2 or 3. Maybe a 4. I don't hate it. It's just a bad movie.
I was going to say 3 or 4.
Shang-Chi like bothers me, even though it's a better movie than TASM 2.
So you hate Shang-Chi more?
Yeah. I wouldn't say I hate Shang-Chi, though. Like, I hate...
You dislike TASM 2.
It's just bad.
So you dislike it.
I don't hate Madam Web. I don't dislike Madam Web, but it's a terrible movie. That's exactly how I feel about TASM 2. TASM 2 is a bad movie. Let's be honest about it. But, you know, it's just... Like, you saying it's... You saying it's better than Homecoming is blasphemy. Yeah. That's ridiculous.
Yeah.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
Wait, yes. Wait. What does he claim? Sorry?
The Amazing Spider-Man 2.
You could...
The one with all of the villains and the terrible... Probably the worst Spider-Man movie he says is better than Spider-Man.
You could argue TASM 2 does some things better than Homecoming, web-slinging and...
Homecoming's the worst thing on
which
the
planet. Which is ridiculous.
Yeah, I'm not going to even take his opinion into account on that.
Whoa! Sorry.
Whoa.
No.
TASM 2
Homecoming,
out of 10.
Homecoming is a good movie, and I don't know why you hate it so strongly. I will never
understand we do know.
For good reason.
I said I will never understand it.
TASM 2 out of 10.
TASM 2 out of 10. I'll give it a 5. I'll give it a 5.
I think that's very fair.
Yeah.
That's fair.
You are... When was the last time you saw it?
2 years ago.
You're forgetting...
I was going to say 4.
All the good things about it. The
calculator. You're forgetting all the stuff with the parents. You're forgetting that they retcon it so that Spider-Man, the guy that's supposed to represent all of us, can only be Andrew Garfield. Oh my gosh.
I do love Andrew Garfield.
He's great.
Yeah.
And him and Emma Stone are great. And people are like, oh, that's such a good part of the movie. They have 15 minutes of screen time because they're away from each other the whole movie.
Yeah, no, those are the two best things about the movie, Andrew Garfield and Emma Stone. Mm-hmm. We'll just leave it at that.
I'm sick of it.
We used to be a proper society. And then No Way Home came out, which I admit is amazing and I love it with all my heart. But then No Way Home came out and everybody's like, oh, TASM 2 is so good.
I think it definitely...
No, you didn't exist before 2021.
I think it definitely upped people's like, okay, you know what? Maybe we'll take a second look at Andrew Garfield Spider-Man movies.
Yeah.
Now, there were some Andrew Garfield stands, you know, shout out to Birdo because he has been on the Andrew Garfield Spider-Man train since it came out. But No Way Home definitely made a lot of people go back and like, you know what? Let me check out Andrew Garfield Spider-Man again. He's good.
There's good parts of the movie.
In your defense, like in the defense of Andrew Garfield, he is Spider-Maning circles around the other two in No Way Home.
Yeah.
So much better than the other two.
So why isn't that something I can like in TASM 2?
It is something you can like in TASM 2. It's something that I like in TASM 2. Unfortunately, you because you like that so much, you act like the rest of the movie does not exist.
No, I don't.
So, you like the Electro in that movie?
He does.
Yes.
Ridiculous.
Okay. No.
Ridiculous.
No, it's not ridiculous.
I'm sick of
the TASM 2 slander. I'm sick of it.
It is kind of ridiculous.
No, I'm sick of it.
I love Jamie Foxx too, but I can admit that
The Amazing Spider-Man 2 with Andrew Garfield is not a perfect movie. I never said it has been, but is it fun? Yes. Is it heartfelt? Of course. Is it beloved? Absolutely.
Not many.
There may come a day where I bend and I bow a knee to you bullies and say that TASM 2 is not a great movie and that it's not a genuine freaking absolute treasure, but today is not that day.
Andrew Garfield is beloved by many.
Yes.
Cook.
Spider-Man 2, Amazing Spider-Man 2 is not.
No, there are people out there, and I sound a general call.
Well, you're gonna find a group of fans like for every bad movie, you know?
What? That's so rude.
Yeah. I'm a fan of bad movies
of
too.
Course.
Some fans, you know, we all love
Revenge of the Sith.
He's getting insulted because you're saying you love it.
Right.
And
right.
It's a bad
right.
Movie.
Right. Right.
Out there who have been shamed and abused and ridiculed, I say rise up. TASM 2 is coming back.
Stop Asian.
Are they making a TASM 3?
Ooh, would you like to see a TASM 3?
I would.
In the Venomverse?
I would.
I think that would be good.
Oh,
just as long as
the Venomverse.
Just as long as they don't fucking...
No!
I hate that
No,
verse
don't do it
so
in that
much.
Verse. Don't do it in that verse.
I hate it so much.
Tom
I hate it so much.
I love Tom Hardy.
There was a time...
That Eddie Brock might be the biggest bozo in a universe that we've seen.
There was a time where I would have liked to see it, but at this point, that versus just destroyed. Yeah, it's gone.
I can't believe we're getting a third. They make so much money.
Hey, man, it's the Last Dance.
Oh, thank God.
It's so gross.
Last Dance and no Spider-Man.
They are re-releasing
yes.
all the Spider-Man movies into theaters. TASM 2 is May 13th. I have bought upwards of 50 tickets to a showing in Burbank, and I sound a general call to TASM 2 stands to join me!
They will.
In a Wafello Escape Pod event.
He put a skate pod in there so that I would pay him half.
I think
you're getting a bill for this. We're going to celebrate this film. There is a Google form in the description and in all of our links and bios in all of our socials.
Andrew, I think they're going to support you, not TASM 2.
No, they're going to support both. If you are in the area and able to come to the screening, fill out the form, because we are going to pack this theater with people who love Spider-Man, who love each other and love this movie.
That's a great message, you know?
And we're going to give a big middle finger to people like this.
Go ahead.
And say, yes, I like The Amazing Spider-Man. And no, I will not stop.
I'm going to just be sitting outside the theater. Is this Burbank? Is that the one with Batman?
Yes.
I'm going to be sitting next to Batman. And when all of you hundreds of people come out that came with Andrew, come out and all of you are like, wow, this movie is so much worse now that I'm not 12.
We're gonna go, yes.
I wonder if Thank the theater you. Experience, though, like bringing that back, will also so much have people enjoy movie. It. I don't know.
Let me finish by quoting yet another amazingly beautiful film. And as everyone knows, one of my favorites.
You should do voiceover work.
As the bearded lady in The Greatest Showman sang, when the sharpest words want to cut me down, I'm going to send a flood, going to drown them out. I am brave. I am bruised. I am who I'm meant to be. This is me.
Stop Asian hate.